Something that would be a pleasing thing for you And Lord, we know that the Constitution was put forth because of people that were put together to bring forth something that would make this nation that would be approved by you. And so tonight, Lord, we give you this country in a very special way, and we as Tea Party Patriots thank you for allowing us to be a part of this great country. Amen. Amen. Let us pray.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Reverend Bean. We've got a pretty good program tonight, so we're not going to spend a lot of time with business announcements. But one of the things that we need to stress is that the Congress is on recess at this particular point. This is the time that you become a true activist. Find out where the town halls are. On each chair, you're not on each chair. I had 20 some copies, so I put them on every other chair. So there are some extra copies laying around. If you didn't get one, just take it up another chair. But there's listings of who's having town halls and who is not having town halls. Now, if they're not having a town hall in your district or your senator or congressman is not doing it, see what you can do to create one. There's nothing together, nothing wrong with getting a group of people together and having your own town hall. There was a group of people, I think it was in Idaho or someplace, who did this, and they had something like 500 people show up, and they had cutouts of the congressman who refused to have a town hall. So they had their own town hall, and man, he wasn't there. He was defenseless. And the media, the interesting thing, the media picked up on this and found out they were doing it. So they came and covered it. So the fact that he wasn't there, he was there, because it ended up in the newspaper. On September the 10th, we have a march on DC. It is a march dressed just to defund Obamacare. Again, when they get back in September, that's the first thing on the agenda is Obamacare. Now, one of the things that we're stressing is correct messaging. We don't want to say we're trying to get the government to defund Obamacare, because in fact what happens, the media turns it around and says that they do it and the government shuts down it, so it's big bad conservatives that made that happen. So what we're stressing to the congressional people to work through the congressional system is delay Obamacare. Obama has delayed Obamacare in several areas. For instance, the government has just delayed what they have to do. They delayed it for businesses, but they haven't done it for the individual citizens. So we want to stress that they need to delay Obamacare for the citizens. The only way they can do that is for Congress to pass a law where there's no money for Obamacare. Obama has said if that happens, he will veto it. If they can pull this off with the proper messaging and send him that bill where he has to veto it and the government shuts down, they didn't do it. All they wanted to do was delay it. They didn't want him to shut the government down. So Obama then shuts the government down, not the conservatives. The only other message I have is we're going to be here same place, same time next month on September the 9th. And we have the Reverend Smiley from WDU and Radio, who will be our guest speaker, and he will be stressing Common Core, which is another critical problem we have with our school system. That program is so bad that it almost takes, at the local level, any representation in the school away from any PTA. You wouldn't even have a PTA if Common Core is put through the way the government wants to go through. That's something, if you don't know anything about it, you need to study it, you need to learn what they're doing. It was bad enough when we had No Child Left Behind, which I thought was really, really good, until 6 years later we found out that most of the teachers were cheating on the tests in order to get the money that was being handed down from the government on the No Child Left Behind. So they were leaving the child left behind with phony grades. So, you know, it seems like every time the government does something like that, something else comes along to undermine what they really intended to do. Common Core is not good. With that in mind, we have a young man here that was elected the president of the Future Business Leaders of America for the state last spring. And he's been doing state work. This past summer, he decided that he would like to possibly go to the national convention and see what he could do there. So he did. He went to the convention, I think it was in June, in Anaheim. And while he was there, he was elected the national president of Future Business Leaders of America. Since he's been back home, he's spoken to lots of groups in the area. I found out that he had spoken to the GOP in Dawson County. And a number of the, I don't know how many of you know Vernon Smith, but he's Mr. Dawson County practically. He called me one day and he said, you've got to get this young man to speak to your group. He said, hey, this guy is marvelous. He's also spoken at, I don't know if he actually spoke down at the Capitol building here, but he's attended meetings down there. He's been at two meetings with Congressman Collins and Graves. He has a meeting coming up in Las Vegas. We'll have to ask him what that's about. I don't think he's old enough to go out and gamble. So he has to be up to some good. So put your hands together and let's welcome Cole Simmons.
Good evening. Like Mr. Frey said, my name is Cole Simmons, and I'm the FBLA National President. I'm also a senior at Dawson County High School. Now, what is Future Business Leaders of America? Founded in 1942, so we just celebrated our 70th birthday recently, we are the largest and oldest student business organization in the world, with over 250,000 members in 46 states, the Virgin Islands, Puerto Rico, the Department of Defense schools in Europe, and we now have chapters in South Korea and China. We're co-curricular, which means that when students learn skills in business classes through workshops, conferences, and namely competitive events, these students can put what they've learned to the test and be prepared to be tomorrow's leaders. We're also nonprofit, which means every dollar that we take in goes to improving the experience and the future of our members. We have a partnership with the March of Dimes, which is a charitable organization founded by FDR to combat polio. Now, when polio was eradicated, they switched their focus to premature births. And with the over $500,000 that FBLA members donate every year, as well as the other donations they receive, they have changed the statistic from 1 in 8 babies being born premature to 1 in 9, which is huge. Now, a little more about my journey. I didn't always know that I wanted to be a national president. My dad was an FBLA state officer back when he was in high school, so I always grew up hearing about how his experiences in FBLA were some of the best of his life. But my freshman year, I was just an average member. In fact, I only signed up to compete because my brother had competed and I wanted to be better than him. Signing up to compete ended up being one of the best decisions of my life because that competition took me to our national conference, which was in Orlando that year. And there, I met the right people that I was appointed to be a region officer for my sophomore year. There, I continued to make connections, but also looked up to the state officers and knew that is what I wanted to be. So at our state conference in March of my sophomore year, I was elected to be the communications vice president. And throughout that year, I knew that I wanted to take the next step and become the Georgia FBLA state president. And 1 year later, in our state leadership conference in March of my junior year, I was elected. Now, being state president of Georgia was really cool because Georgia has been the largest state chapter for 11 years. We have 20,000 members, and I think that there's an FBLA chapter in roughly 90% of public high schools in Georgia. Now, I thought that running for national president was going to be impossible because we hadn't had a national president in so long. But a lot of people told me that I had to run, so I did. But it took me a while to decide that. In fact, I decided that I wanted to run 1 month before our national leadership conference, whereas my opponents had been preparing for this campaign for years. It was a stressful month, but I did all the work that needed to be done. And when the national conference rolled around, I had to give a speech in front of 9,000 people, campaign at a booth for 2 days straight, do a Q&A session, and at the end of the conference, was finally elected the first Georgia FBLA national president in 41 years. Now, what can you do? There are really two main things. Back about 2 or 3 weeks ago, myself and my fellow national officers created a program of work that we're really excited about. We have a lot of new national programs, as well as revisions to old national programs that we think will take the organization to the next level. But with these programs come a financial burden. So if anybody would like to make donations, either yourself or your business, we have recognition for businesses, you can contact me at FBLAPRES@FBLA.org. That's FBLAPRES@FBLA.org. Also, one of the things that allows organizations like FBLA or FFA or FCCLA, DECA, FFA, students to get involved in what they're interested in and pursue their passions, what allows those to exist is the Carl D. Perkins Act. And I understand that it's being reconsidered soon. So I ask all of you to consider the Carl D. Perkins Act because it has changed so many millions of lives in the past and has the opportunity to change so many millions more in the future. Now, if anybody has any questions, I'd be happy to answer those.
What was the email again?
It's FBLAPRES@FBLA.org. I also have business cards if any of you would like to see me at the end, so that's already in writing. And you can also like my Facebook page, which is FBLA National President, to keep up to date on things I'm working on. Thank you for having me. And yes?
Could you give us an example? What would one of the local chapters work on? Mm-hmm.
There are certain responsibilities that are up to the chapter, as well as there are things that chapters involve on the state level. So I know, for example, my local chapter has community service opportunities, like we raise money for the March of Dimes. We also take field trips down to Turner Field to learn about how their management runs and efficiently operates the stadium, as well as World of Coke. And we hold chapter meetings to encourage our members to recruit. At our region conference, we have 6A schools in our region. Our local chapter was actually the number one chapter in terms of competition. We had the most winners. It's really up to the chapter, but then they can also go on to compete in the state and national conferences.
Do you stress capitalism?
We don't get too much into, we do have like America Saves Day, and we do stress entrepreneurship, but we stress entrepreneurship in business.
That's capitalism.
Yeah, capitalism.
Business leader, what is exactly it that do you work with companies? Do you work with just charitable organizations?
Myself? I work with
your chapter.
Okay. The chapter is mainly self-contained, so it's members interacting with each other, as well as we have the advisor that coordinates all of that. So we don't have too much involvement with businesses. Sometimes we have guest speakers come in from local businesses to talk about, I guess, advice that they wish they had known at that age, things that would have made their lives easier. So on the local level, it's a mix of a good demographic of people.
Yes. Is this a project-oriented organization, or is it an education-oriented organization? A typical meeting is comprised of what?
A typical meeting, we usually update members on what's coming up and what they can get involved in. There's nothing that says that they have to get involved in anything. And a lot of members just pay dues and don't do anything. But those that want to get involved, they can do projects for their for the March of Dimes. They can do projects for their competition. But then that also stresses education. So it is a mix of projects that do stress education.
Could we come to a meeting?
Absolutely.
Can you tell us a little more about the Carl Perkins Act? I don't know very much about that, and I don't mean to put you on the spot. Is that a fair question?
Yes. The Department of Education, it's a federal grant. So, for example, in Georgia, the Georgia Department of Education applies for this grant. And then, if they receive it, it's, I think, 20% stays with the state, and 80% goes to local chapter or local high schools. And then each high school has a person in charge of dividing up those funds. And they're meant for career and technical student organizations, which is an umbrella that covers FBLA, FFA, DECA. So it's a federal grant that's eventually broken down to local chapters for all organizations.
And you were saying that that is being reconsidered?
Yes.
As to whether to pass it for the next 5-10 years? Or so?
I think it'll be passed, but I think most of it is being cut. A lot of people want cuts to be made, less money to be distributed. And if there was less money, then I know that these chapters, a lot of them would dwindle and cease to exist.
Have you thought if the federal money does dwindle, forming a partnership with some of these big corporations and industries here that may be willing to donate to you and actually have you guys get kind of mentor you guys? Have you thought about something like that?
We do have some big corporations, especially on the national level, that do give us donations. A lot of that goes to the workings of the National Center. So while we do receive the sponsorships, we don't have enough to support every single chapter.
Right, but I'm talking about Georgia, like the Georgia chapter reach out to industries headquartered here in Georgia and see about a mentor program and see about some of the funding and impact contributions and things like that, give your funding.
We're absolutely looking into that actively, but I don't think that could still be a replacement for what we receive, just in terms of how many chapters we have and how many students are involved.
How much are they talking about cutting?
It depends on who you talk to. Different people have different ideas on how much they want to cut.
But that's an idea, because you guys could set up an education. Have a
C career, which is nonprofit
education tax deductible.
Some
of the corporations could donate their contributions
to tax deductible. Absolutely. We're definitely seeking out
the
opportunities.
Yes. I'm curious, when you're talking grant from the federal government to the state of Georgia, I have no idea what kind of dollars you're talking. What kind of grant might Georgia get in a typical year?
I don't think they're allowed to disclose to the students the actual amount.
Okay.
I think that's typically something that they keep to themselves.
You can find that out.
Yeah.
Other questions? All right. Well, thank you for having me.
Thank you, Paul. Before we go a little bit further, we do have some dignitaries here. Mark Hamilton just slipped in the back door. You understand, Mark? Every Dooley from the Tea Party Patriots National Board is sitting on the floor. We've got several of the Area Tea Party people here. Mark Scupine and Ron Hopper is with him. There is the distinguished young man that can't think of his name right now.
Roger.
Jack Smith is sitting over here. Have I missed anybody? In the back row back here, we've got, I saw Rob Watson come in from, you're not in Dawson County, you're in
Pickett County.
And back in the back here, we have Mark Williams, who is welcome new to the area. Mike Williams. So, at this particular point, we have another dignitary here, and he's actually going to introduce Senator Murphy, and that's Brad Wilkins from the local GOP organization in Forsyth. Brad?
Good evening. Can you guys all hear me?
Yes.
All right, I'm going to put this down. I'm gonna cause trouble if I try to put this voice over that microphone. The space-time continuum will break or something. It'll hurt somebody. I'm Brad Wilkins. I know most of you here one way or another. I feel like I'm amongst friends. I am the chairman of your local Forsyth County Republican Party. And every once in a while, I have the privilege of introducing a fellow Republican, an elected official, in a meeting like this. But again, I kind of feel that this group, you know, as it grows, a lot of us already know each other. And sometimes we get a little used to seeing our elected officials here. Today will not be the last, and it certainly has not been the first time that we've seen Senator Jack Murphy amongst us. And the funny thing is, the more familiar we get with our elected officials, we get a little bit spoiled because we see these guys with us. We get to ask them questions. In a county like Forsyth County, there's a great opportunity for us to get to know our elected officials. So I'm just going to take a couple quick minutes to tell you a couple things about Jack that you may not know or you may not have been thinking about when you came in today. And when I think about leadership, I think of two organizations for a man to learn leadership: business and the military. The military, the person learned, they swear an oath to uphold and defend our Constitution. They learn an honor code. They live by an honor code. Military leaders have to put other people ahead of their own interests. In business, to succeed, you've got to know the secret to American exceptionalism, which this young man knows about. The free enterprise system, capitalism, I'm going to throw it out there. To compete, you not only make a product and make a service and make it better than anybody else, but you have to know how to cut waste and cut it fast. And when you find somebody who's had both opportunities in their life to learn, to serve, and to lead, you probably have someone who might make a heck of a good public servant. And our Senator Jack Murphy's had both. He served 4 years in the U.S. Air Force. Then afterwards, he went on to a private career. He worked his way up through working to become a regional vice president. And then he took all that experience and he formed his own company, Radar Exterminating. And he took it from a fairly small business, I'm not sure if any business people here know how hard this is, and he grew from about $100,000 a year to $7.5 million a year. So he's had the opportunity to, you know, grow and learn and experience a lot of things, and he took all that and he started serving us down at the gold dome. Jack served two terms in the assembly. And then in 2007, he was elected to serve us as Senator Jack Murphy. And if you want to know a little bit more about how he's governed and how he's served, just recently he's earned an award from the American Conservative Union Foundation for their 2013 Conservative Award for his service this last year. So I'm pleased to announce and to introduce, you guys can all stand up for a second, come on, get some blood going here. Stand up, and come on. Our good friend, Senator Jack Murphy.
Well, I'm honored this evening, Gundy. We've got the big guns out here. We got Debbie here and the big guns here, so I'm honored to be here tonight. Also, we have my good friend, Mark Hamilton, Representative Hamilton, who I've known for years. He's actually the best friend at my wedding, best man at my wedding. But I'm not sure I'm going to talk to him about that later on. And then I have another special guest here. I have my daughter-in-law, Susan Connor. Susan and I get into some discussions every now and then and talk about things, so I'm glad to have her here tonight, and Ralph Davis and several other friends in the room that I know. What I want to do is just kind of go over, for those of you that don't know, I served two terms in the House. I was in the House one term when we had exactly in the minority. And, you know, I used to joke around and say, well, no use going to any committee meetings because they won't listen to anything we say anyway. So we just vote red and go home, you know. And, of course, when we got into the majority, it was like, wait a minute. Now we've got to do something. You know, we've got to watch what we say because we're going to have to follow it up and have to do something. So that was an interesting time in that. Ever since those last 8 years, 10 years, we've been in the majority, as you well know. My current assignment down there is chairman of the Regulated Industries and Utilities Committee, which is a huge committee encompassing a lot of areas. Regulated Industries is in control. Everything has to come through my committee for the change of any licensing. That means doctors, lawyers, air conditioning, plumbers, whatever. If there's change in that licensing, it has to come through the Regulated Industries Committee. And of course, the interesting part about regulating industries is alcohol. It also controls all alcohol regulated industries within the state. Alcohol, beer, wine, liquor, moonshine, whatever you want to talk about, we are in control of that. And then the anything to do with the utilities has to come through our committee. That doesn't have to go through the PSC. The PSC, of course, has a lot of control over utilities and what happens with the utilities down there. Then occasionally they have to bring a lot of things through us. But it also encompasses cable and wireless and internet and broadband and cell towers and all of that stuff. So it's a huge, huge committee, and it's very active down there. Before that, I was chairman of banking, and then before that, I was chairman of public safety. Brad mentioned my service, my 4 years of service in the Air Force. I want everybody to say, I'm classified as a Vietnam veteran. But I want everybody to understand, I never set foot in Vietnam. We was all over Europe, flying all over Europe, supporting a lot of the missions in Vietnam, but I never went to Vietnam, and thank goodness for the guys and women that went there, but I'm glad I didn't have to go. So, you know, I enjoyed my time in the service, enjoyed serving our country, and fighting for our freedom wherever we can fight for them. Still admire all of the service people that do that today. One of the pieces of legislation that we passed this time that came through my committee was it allowed service people who are serving now or have served in the past, if they're in the air conditioning, if they were in the service and say they were repairing air conditioners or doing air conditioning, high back work, or say there was an electrician and they were doing that kind of work in the service, well, now they can come out and they can go directly and get their license without having to go through an exam. Now, they have to go through a review board. They have to look at their qualifications and make sure they wasn't installing air conditioners and pup tents or something, that they really have to know what they're doing. They have to either meet or exceed requirements of the state of Georgia. But this is fast-tracking our veterans, which are going to be coming home soon, a lot of them, and fast-tracking them into the employment and getting them out there to so they can benefit their families and benefit society. So that was one good bill that we brought before the committee. Some other bills we brought forth and are still hanging out there are some of the alcohol bills. Now, in the legislature, when you're down there, there's two things that really get people excited. One of them is taxes. Anything about taxes, you know, they get excited. But another thing they really get excited about is alcohol. And when you say, well, we're going to have this bill. And the first thing you get into some senator out there saying, liquor bill, and you can be in the, well, it doesn't matter whether it's just something minor or something major. They're going to make a big deal out of it. So we have to get it out of the Senate or out of the House, one or the other. And it takes a long, drawn out process to do that. But some of the bills that faced us this last year, there was six or seven alcohol bills. And I'd like to get your opinion on this. Now, only let a couple of them out of committee. The rest of them we have in a study committee that's acting this month. We're going to talk about it. Now, they want to have, right now, you can have beer and wine tastings in a beer and wine store. But you can't have beer and wine tastings in one of these mega stores, the liquor store and the beer and wine. You can't have it in that. Now, that's one of the bills that they got. But the problem is they tacked liquor tastings onto that bill. Now, liquor tastings, think about this. You can have a couple ounces of liquor in a liquor tasting at a liquor store. Now, within this, where we're sitting, probably 3 miles, we've got 5 or 6 liquor stores. Now, all of a sudden on Saturday, they want to have liquor tastings, all of them, you know, at the same time. Well, I tell you, that bothers me, because I think we're going to put some drunk people on the road, you know, by the time we get through going around to all these liquor tastings. So that bothers me. I wouldn't hear that bill. I thought we'd put it in the study committee and kind of see. How do y'all feel about that? You think we need to have liquor tastings?
No. I think they know what it tastes like.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. And I think they know what the effect is, you know. So they try to tell me, well, oh, you can drink a couple of beers and it'll be the same as the liquor thing. Well, I don't know where you're from, but no. You know, you got 4% proof or 6% alcohol against 86 to 120% proof. No, it's not the same. So, you know, we've got a problem with that. And then we got the moonshiners up in Dawsonville wanting to sell moonshine across the county. Well, we have retailers out here, and we have distributors that these places can go through and distribute their product to these different retailers. Let them sell it, but they want to sell it across the county. Plus, we got some other breweries want to sell their product across the county. Well, you know, if we allow a brewery, these microbreweries, to do that, then what's to stop me from going down to Miller and Albany or up to Budweiser, in fact, you know, back in my pickup truck there, so just load it up, you know. I mean, it's not real simple, you know, to take care of these things. And so I just don't want us to go down that slippery slope and open up a can of worms on something that we will regret later on. So that's kind of what's going on with part of that. Another thing that you're really interested in, and I've heard from a lot of you on it, is the Common Core. What's being done on the Common Core? Common Core, long before we ever really got down to the nitty-gritty on this Common Core, I was worried about it because of what our children was reading, what they're being assigned, you know, to read. So, just so happened today, I met with the governor and the lieutenant governor. And the governor is working, he told me that they're working on some changes to the Common Core in the curriculum in the state. And that I was going to like it, and the citizens of the state's going to like it. He wouldn't tell me anything beyond that. But he said he's working on it. They're working on it. It's a work in progress. So he's aware of it. You know, he's already a few months ago said that we're not going to share the information, you know, the student information, by executive order. And, you know, just a couple of weeks ago, he said we're not going to participate in the testing because it's going to cost $27 million. No, I mean, I don't understand that. Our tests, when we give other tests, they're, what, $5, $6 a piece. And these tests are way beyond that, you know, cost us a lot more than that, so we're just having one. But those are just the things that that's out there that, that you know, you can kind of look at and make sense of them real quick. But I saw something on television the other day that really wasn't on television, it was on YouTube. And it had a children's book, and it was, I forget what kind of book it was. And you flip to this, and they're talking about a six-year-old kid, you know, and saying that they need to be looking at ways to be socially active and socially be of service to the community, community organizers. Now, who does that sound like? I mean, you know, it's ridiculous. And when you look at some of this stuff, it even gets more ridiculous. And of course, a lot of you have heard from Jack Smith. If you hadn't heard from him and you've got, and you want to know some information about Common Core, you need to get on his email list, on his email distribution list, because he has some great information on it. And also, Senator Ligon has put out some good information on it. But, you know, they talk about they're moving algebra, you know, one from the eighth grade to the ninth grade. Okay, if they move algebra from the eighth grade to the ninth grade, then you're not gonna, it's not gonna have, the kids are not gonna have time to get calculus, you know, in the system. They're not gonna have time to do it. Another thing is, that's more confusing, is the parents across Georgia reported that their children, some as young as kindergarten, which is like the sixth grade I was talking about, are coming home in tears because their math lessons are so confusing. They're so confusing of how, because our teachers really, you know, bless their heart, they're trying to teach something that they really don't understand and really don't understand the curriculum about it. So that's for one of the problems is. And then they dictate teaching geometry by an experimental method never used successfully. Never used successfully K through 12. So I mean, you know, we're playing with these kids' lives out here with this Common Core. And the worst part about it is this one teacher, a Georgia English teacher, said that will we ever get to read about anything other than oppression and social justice? I mean, you know, it's clear indoctrination. It's yes. Indoctrination of our students, of our kids. And we're sitting here, you know, and it's slowly being indoctrinated. And I applaud the people that has gotten on board with this and getting the information out so the public understands that we've got a real problem. Now, having said that, I really believe in parental guidance. Parents have to take an active part in their children's education. They have to look at what they're reading. You know, my granddaughter, she was reading some stuff that I thought, man, where did this come from? You know, where is Tom Sawyer and Treasure Island and all that kind of stuff? And they're wanting to read all this complicated stuff that had a lot of sexual explicit material in it and socializing and how do we do this and how do we just clear indoctrination. And we've got a problem with that and we're going to have to stop it. And I applaud you to keep on doing it. And I thank you. Governor said today, and I don't want to put words in the governor's mouth, but what he said was they're working on something, and I believe it, that's going to help the situation a whole lot. He's already helped it by not sharing the information in camp and the suspended testing. Another thing we got out there, and of course this is a federal issue, is the Affordable Care Act. I mean, affordable to who? I mean, you know, we talk about a moving target, and I'm not going to get into it too much of it because, you know, nobody understands it. It's moving every day. The President of the United States is changing it every day. You know, we've got the businesses not going to have to comply with it for a year. but individuals do. How crazy is that? You know. And can we defund it? We might be able to defund it, but they're going to say we're going to shut down the government. And if we're going to do that, if we're going to go down that road, then you better be prepared to back. And you better be able to stay the course on it. Now, the Supreme Court, when they ruled on that, they ruled that it was a tax. And so what can you do with a tax? You're not funded. So that's one thing. But, you know, that's one avenue. But we just need to stop it. And the more pressure we get, I signed on every piece of legislation down at the Gold Dome that had anything to do with resolutions of stopping Obamacare. And we just need to keep on, because I think Washington is now feeling the hit and the heat when their own unions come out and say they're against it, then, you know, there's a problem. And I think they're realizing that. So we'll have to see how that goes. But as far as what's coming up with the next session, I can't see anything on the horizon. There's some bills that's left over that's going to have to be looked at as to whether we move them forward or not. We'll be talking about some tax savings and what we can do along those lines, but I'm not sure what we can do yet. We'll be talking about some educational issues. That'll be coming up. One thing that concerns me with our education is I think our children are losing the ability to communicate. When they sit across the table and text each other, instead of talking to one another, they are losing that ability. We are going to create a lot of introverts that are afraid to interact. And that really concerns me. Plus, I think the educators are finally realizing that we can't, everybody's not going to go to college. And we're going to have some tradespeople out here that can do some work. You know what the number one job that we're asked to supply in Georgia is?
Welders.
You know, we get requests from all over the states. Other states, you can't get a welder, you know. And these welders, they only make $80,000 to $85,000 a year. So, I mean, you know, that's a pretty good occupation. So we need to, you know, start looking at that. We need to channel these kids that's coming out of high school into our tech school so they wind up doing something that's beneficial to them and their families, and they can make a decent living and, you know, learn something to do out here rather than going down. And nothing wrong with flipping hamburgers at McDonald's if you're still going to school or something, but they need to learn to do something more than that. Of course, if the federal government has its way, we'll be paying people that work at McDonald's $30 an hour. So, you know, that might be a pretty good job when that happens. But that's kind of, you know, I'm concerned about that. And I met with some educators up at the college the other day. We had a really big seminar about what's going on in education. And I told them that really concerned me about the communications, because everybody wants to email. Everybody wants voicemail. You got people that will not answer their phone, they'll just let it go to voicemail. And then they'll email the person, you know. And a lot of them, you say, well, you know, why didn't you call me? Oh, well, I emailed you, you know. Well, that's going in the wrong direction. This technology is great. I mean, it is a great thing, but we've got to watch it. We've got to make sure our kids can communicate, or we're going to be in serious trouble later on down the road. But that's, I'm going to look forward to your questions. And I got to get my my flat jacket.
I do have a question, but I wanted to thank the Senate and Senate leadership. You guys really came through on when we needed help on the ethics bill. I'm sorry. I just want to thank the Senate and Senate leadership for the work that they did on the ethics bill to stand up for grassroots activists.
It's very much appreciated. I know that I happen to know because I got texts. We were getting texts from David Schaefer and some of the others till like 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, but you guys stood firm.
Right.
And I just want to let you know we appreciate that. Yeah. We appreciate, you know, the fact what you did. I do have a question about T-Splost. I heard, I actually saw Senator Vincent Ford last week, I believe I saw him last week, and just happened to run into him. He talked about that there may be some kind of T-Splost legislation coming down that would actually be the kind of legislation that it should have been to start with, which was originated in the Senate, that would allow counties to decide if they want to partner with other counties for transportation projects. And I just wanted to see if that would have a chance of passing. It maybe repeal the penalty that the regions that did not. But I can tell you that had something like that happened that would actually have local control and allow counties to make that decision and be more constitutional, I think that you would have saw a different result.
So you would be in favor of something like that?
I think a lot of people, I saw Albany would be in favor as long as you could, the local counties could decide and make that decision. And if it were constitutional, according to that Georgia Constitution. Nolan Cox, I saw an email from him, but we asked the Senate last year, Tommy Williams, you know, can you change the bill? Ed Setzler introduced legislation. It never went anywhere, but I mean, as long as counties can make the decision, if they decide that they want to partner with somebody, they can partner with somebody, and the county commission has to vote on everything, and they choose. You know, as long as it's local control and constitutional, whether or not we would support a tax that would go along with that, that would be up to the different counties on that. But I mean, I think that would be something that we would not object to. We tried to get them to, Senator Williams actually changed the legislation for the vote last year to basically what they were talking about introducing and, you know, repeal the penalty for the regions that did not pass it along with it. That might be something good.
Debbie, I hadn't heard of anything coming down the pipe. Have you heard anything on that?
It's always discussed, but when they... There's a lot of people that would say that even the penalty is really a misnomer, that actually the match is better for those communities than it was. So there's a lot of lack of clarity on that. And the other thing, obviously, if something like that does happen, or to do something like that, I mean, the simple reality, not throw anybody under the bus, Governor Perdue would not allow that to happen.
Yes, sir. I heard the same thing.
It was the reality. We had a number of options, the opt-in, opt-out provision, and he was absolutely adamant.
You are correct. I was told by numerous people when we asked, why did you not pass the Senate version to begin with? I was personally sat in a meeting with a lot of the leadership, and they said exactly what you said, that was not the way Governor Perdue wanted it, which the Senate would have been more in line with the Constitution and local control.
The reality is that the revenue bill has to start in the House anyway.
Yes.
There might be something that comes up on this next term, this next session, but it being an election year, I'm not sure that it'll be brought up, and it is a revenue bill, so it does have to have start in
the House.
And not in the Senate. So, you know, we'll have to see, but I hadn't heard of anything.
He had just mentioned that because we worked together on a piece of loss, and we just happened to run into each other. I almost didn't recognize him. And, you know, he was talking about that because he knew that I wanted, you know, we wanted to repeal or whatever that is. But had it been done like that to start with, I think you would have seen it. Well, I mean, you know, whether or not the counties, it would have been more local control and not regionalism forced upon counties.
only see in time, you have to be in a region with this, this county.
Is Common Core United Nations, and if so, isn't it geared towards making us, from the children on up, is global citizens rather than American citizens?
Reverend, you know, I think you've got it. You know, it is tied to the United Nations. And like I've said in many, many times before in a lot of open meetings, if it's tied to the United Nations, I'm against it.
Amen.
We just need to abolish it.
Amen.
I mean, that's really, who thinks that we know better in the state of Georgia how to educate our children and what the curriculum should be than us? You know, now, we don't know what they're doing in Montana. I don't know how they educate their children. I don't know how they educate them in Wyoming. But why should we have to be put in the barrel with them? You know, we have. We just need to get rid of the education department. And
but
we'll get a lot better
be
off.
Accepting federal monies, which is what the Department of Education was set up for under Jimmy Carter. As long as you keep accepting federal monies, you're never going to change
you're
the
exactly
education
right.
system.
We would have to give up the money.
And I was married to a man born and raised in Hungary under communism. And I worked for a man born and raised in Cuba under communism, and they both told me, the way you change a nation is through education and the media.
Yep.
And we are doing that. In 35 years, our children believe in socialism. I have 17-year-olds telling me it's wonderful what the government's doing and all the money they're handing out, but they're being educated, as you said, from the. So what are you doing, and what are the people in the capital of Georgia doing to start eliminating federal money so that you can take charge of your school again? But until you eliminate the money from Washington, you're not changing anything, Senator.
We talked about that. We talked about eliminating the money, not only that money, but other money as well that's coming in from Washington.
But they keep accepting it. As soon as the government says we're not going to give you 10 cents, you follow the road to Washington.
Don't say you.
Maybe not you, but the state of Georgia does.
Thank you. Thank you. But yeah, the state of Georgia, there's a lot of us down there that would like to do away with that and not accept the money.
Right.
Period. Because I think we can do it without their money. And we can do a better job with that.
Well, you
money.
Did prior to the Carter administration.
We what?
Prior to the Carter administration, states were in control of their curriculum.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But now, you know, for years and years and years, this state was completely controlled by the Democratic government, you know, in the federal. And it didn't start changing until actually Senator Perdue came in as far as the legislature. And the reason for that is because the state started changing to more conservative values than what they've had. Now, a lot of old Democrats are very conservative. Don't misunderstand me. They're very conservative. There's a lot of them that, as you know, have switched from being Democrats to Republicans, you know, because their district is changing. And they had always been conservative. But, unfortunately, they couldn't get elected. So that's one thing that's happened. But, yeah, you're exactly right. We need to stop accepting the money. And not only that, on some other areas.
And we are changing the face of the nation, and we are teaching our children that socialism is the greatest invention in the world.
But, there again, you need to get back to the parents and get them doing that. The problem is some of our young parents, they believe in socialism. They believe that they're entitled.
That system.
They believe that the government is supposed to support them and give them everything. They believe in that. But, you know, I had my granddaughter come up to me. She was about, maybe 13 when she come up to this. And she said, well, Granddad, what is socialism? I said, well, let me tell you. I said, you're living in a big old house, aren't you? She said, yeah. I said, you got a pretty big bedroom, haven't you? She said, yeah. I said, well, now, you know, how would you like it if we were to just take and say there's a lot of room in that house, there's a lot of room in your bedroom. We're going to move five other people in your bedroom. And you don't know them, they're completely strangers, but we're just going to put them in your bedroom and maybe 10 or 15 more people in your house, and use that, you know. I said, how'd you like that? Oh, no, I wouldn't like that. I said, well, that's socialism. Yeah. So she understood. But we need to tell people what socialism is. All you got to watch is Dr. Javago, and you'll see what socialism is. You know, what happened to those folks? So, you know, but you're right.
Let's move on to this young man in the corner.
Yeah, I'd like to know, what chances do you think the legislature will have in preventing the use of foreign law in Georgia courts this session? In sponsoring the American Law for American Court resolution?
Well, you're getting into an area that I really don't know much about. I think there's going to be a lot of complications in that when we start doing it, because what they're going to start talking about is they're going to go back to the Constitution. For that, and they're going to go back to the Constitution and say, well, you know, the Constitution provides that we should do that, and we should have free speech, and we should, everybody has a right to free trial and all that. So, you know, they would start hanging their hats on that. Plus, they'll bring in the ACLU and anybody else they can to, you know, to take care of that. But other than that, I don't know what chances there are, but if you'll send me some information on it, I'll certainly take a look at it.
Well, Sharia law has already been used in over 50 court cases in this country in 23 states. We want to make sure that doesn't happen here in Georgia.
Well,
and I'd like to know if what we can do to stop
it. Well, there's a lot of people that would be on board with that, but you need to let me know so we can start some action on it and I can get with some of the judicial committee members and, you know, get something started on it.
The contamination of our education system is not limited to the primary and high school ages. It is also firmly in indoctrinating our legal minds in our law schools. And I came down and spoke with you about it last winter, right, about how our law schools are now interpreting the Constitution as being the founding document of our country, which cuts off any access and any flow of authority back to the Declaration of Independence. The ramifications of that are just so far-reaching that it touches everything that our country is all about. And I spoke with you about introducing a resolution. I would like a law in the state of Georgia that simply states that the United States founding document is the Declaration of Independence, to put up a barrier, a firewall in between anyone in the federal government who might try to use any of those rulings that are dependent upon a standalone constitution being our founding document. And I haven't forgotten about that, and I thought I would raise the issue again to prep your mind for it again.
I can't remember. Did you send me a sample legislation on that?
Yes, I did.
Okay. So we need to look at that and see what the sample is. I think I told Jim that we'll look at it in the upcoming session that's coming up in January.
I look forward to it.
2014.
Thank you. Can I ask that, which one is the Constitution?
I'm sorry?
What's wrong with using the Constitution?
The Constitution's fine, but it's not our founding document. The authority for the Constitution goes back to the Declaration of Independence. And so everything that is part of the Declaration of Independence that was part of the reason why we're a nation also is imparted to the Constitution. All that will be lost if our law schools begin to teach to future legal constitutional scholars who will become judges and Supreme Court justices that our Constitution is the founding document. Because the Constitution doesn't really make any sense unless it's viewed in the context of the Declaration of Independence, and that is what's being lost.
When judges rule on cases, they rule based on the Constitution, not on the Declaration of Independence.
And they should rule based on the Constitution, but in the light of the Declaration of Independence and the founding principles of our country.
Let's go up to
God, that's in the Declaration of Independence, not
in the Constitution. I've got a couple of things, Senator.
But on the basic law,
a couple of things. Number one, HB 242, which you may be familiar with, Mr. Hamilton, was pulled, and it has to deal with American law and American courts, and North Carolina has just passed theirs. It's their HB 522, which I've sent you gentlemen some information on that. And also, we would like to see Georgia do that, and we're hoping that 242 will be resurrected and with the proper language get through the legislature about American law. The other thing is, on local legislation, do you really believe that it's fair for statewide representatives and senators to vote on local legislation? Should it not just be the local delegation that votes on that? Because it seems as if, that to us, it seems as if it's like, you'll scratch my back on this, I'll scratch your back on this. And just have y'all vote present if you're not in that local delegation.
Yeah. Very seldom does anything ever come up concerning local legislation that we vote on or interfere with. Because it's local. I mean, you know, it doesn't have anything to do with me or my delegation or my county or my district. So we let that, you know, go forward for them. Yeah. If you check my voting record, you'll find that I've very seldom voted on anything.
I just want to ask, at what point does the state of Georgia have the right to stand up against the federal government?
Yep. Well, we have the right. If you look at Amendment number 10, we have the right. States have the right. We should be in control of the federal government. You know, it says that all of our authority, all the federal government's authority comes from the states. That's what Amendment number 10 says. But unfortunately, over the years, that has, you know, reverted itself. And now the federal government has control over us. You know, with the things that you're talking about, money and stuff like that. That's what's happening. But we're supposed to have control over them. And I support Amendment 10. We need states' rights. You know, we need to run our state.
But yeah. I guess one of these paying the money for highways or anything, basically states have sold themselves out over the last 50 years into the income.
Well, now we send a lot of money up there for highways and we don't get it all back that we sell.
Right. So it's because we pay for it.
There's an interesting thing about power. We granted power to the federal government. And there's an interesting thing about power, and I think this applies to the states. The only time that you have power is when you take it. No one is going to just willfully give you power. So if the states want to stand up against the federal government, then the states are going to have to take the power back. The federal government is not going to give it to us. So I think that's where our legislature needs to begin to stand up and fight for the sovereignty of the state.
Believe it or not, we have resolutions on that already. We've already signed on to it. I've signed on to it. The problem is, it takes 3/4 of all the states to take it.
No.
No, sir. Each individual state is sovereign.
Yes.
Right. So therefore, Georgia by itself can say no to anything that the national government does that is outside the realm of the enumerated powers specifically granted to the national government by the sovereign states.
Right. If we are sovereign states.
We are. Well, there's not enough to it.
We are. I said we are.
Yes.
I didn't say yes. I said we are.
Yes, sir. Thank
you. You know. So, you know, we can do that. We can secede from the Union.
No, we're not seceding from the Union.
No, but I mean, if we're going to start going down the road like that, we're going to have to get a lot of guts and get a lot of people on board. Okay? Now, you've got 236 legislators down there, and a good many of them are Democrats. They're not going to go along with that. So how do we do it? You tell me, and I'll start on it tomorrow.
Yes, sir. We start by forming coalition, like having a conversation between me and you.
Okay.
And then we start spreading that conversation around and using the actual language of our founding fathers and the logic of our founding fathers that they used when they established the national government.
I agree with you.
And by doing that, so what problem that we have in the conservative movement is the failure to message correctly. There's a commercial on television, I don't know if y'all seen it, but it's a 17-year-old Latino, and he is not here legally, and he would love to be able to serve in the United States Marine Corps, but he can't because he's not a citizen of the United States. And I tell you what, that tugs at my heartstrings. You know, I'm a Marine, and so, you know, I understand that. And that kind of message is going to resonate with so many people that will say, yes, he needs to serve in the Marine Corps. But the fact of the matter is, he's here illegally. Now, if you communicate your message just with facts, then it's going to fall on a lot of deaf ears. So we've got to work on doing the message so that the majority out there says, yes, that's what we need to do. And if we do that, then we can bring along those blue dog Democrats and those that have ours beside their names. And we can actually, in this state, we can be an example to the other 49 in this union.
I'm with you, bro.
But it starts by having a conversation. Yes, sir.
How do we get, you know, do we start with these 50 people? I mean, you're the first one I've heard about that. I mean, where is this coalition?
Well, it's got to be within the legislature itself. See, we can talk
to... Is AJC going to help us with that?
Well, I don't know. Maybe they will.
No, they I can tell you that.
And that's fine. But see, you know, I'm from Wayne County. I'm not from Forsyth County. And so I have a conversation with my state senator. I have a conversation with my state representative. And then if they will go and have a conversation with somebody else, and before long, you know, two talks to two and four talks to four, and then it just starts mushrooming.
Have you had a conversation with your senator?
Sir?
Have you had a conversation?
Yes, sir. I've talked to Steve Goodes.
Yeah,
yes,
what is he? What is Senator Goodes?
He seems to be on board.
Well, he hasn't talked to me about it.
He is one of three that represent White County.
Yeah. So you really need to be talking to all of them.
And I do my best to travel around to several different counties in the ninth district.
Well, I'm just saying, I'm with you. If you, I mean, you get it started, we get some publication on, we get some media attention, and I'll be right there with you.
But Senator, the only thing wrong with that, the power is not in the legislature in Georgia. The power is with the people. And people are very complacent today. Tell them that their road will be shut down. No. Tell them that they can't go into a senior center. No. They have become accustomed, including myself, we've become accustomed to so much, we're not prepared to give anything up. And in order to become a sovereign state, you must give things up because we can't afford to pay for them as a sovereign state. So it's a great and wonderful idea, but we're not the Depression era people who did without, or their children who had
what. Well, I'll let you debate him on that, and I'll work that out. I'll tell you one little story, and then I will sit down. Is I had a guy call me one day complaining about the service areas in the state. He said, "Listen, I want these service areas to stay open. I need them to stay open to midnight because I'm driving all the time and they're closed at 5 o'clock. I said, okay. I said, that's fine. That's when I was chairman of the Public Safety Committee. I said, that's fine. I said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to send you a list of our state troopers. I said, I'm going to send you a list of them. I want you to pick out 15 of them that you're going to fight for. Their families, their benefits, vehicles, their insurance, their everything. You just pick out 15 of them you're going to fire, and we'll keep those open. And this goes back to what you're talking about, inflation. And he said, oh, well, I didn't know it was like that. I said, where do you think you get the money from? I mean, you know, we did that for a reason. We'd love to keep them open, keep people employed. But we can't, you know. So, you know, that was one of those.
If legislation came about that basically stated that all citizens of Georgia must send their federal income tax money to the state of Georgia, and the state would then send the federal government their correct portion, whatever the state determined was, would you support that type of legislation?
Well, I would support it if we could ever get it passed. But legally, I have.
Why not?
I'm not an attorney, but I'm just thinking we can do it. I mean, listen, you guys have got some great ideas. And you know, you get out there and stir the pot, and I'll be right there with you.
Are we sovereign or are we not?
We are sovereign.
Then we can do that.
I didn't say we weren't sovereign.
Then we can do that. What? And it would be legal.
You get some legislators to go along with, and I'll be right there with you.
Okay. Before we wind down, because then Anita is back here, and she's been very patient for the last 20 minutes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I understand Governor Hill's going to do this or that with the Common Core, what he's not going to let them do. But how can we be assured this federal government is going to say, Governor Deal, you're not going to do that?
Well, the federal government, we have a right, you know, under that. This all stems from the No Child Left Behind, you know, and that's where it all started at. And, you know, we have a right to do that. Just like we said, we're not going to test. We have a right to do that. And we can pass, you know, legislation within the state that says we don't, that we're not going to do it.
Thank you.
Just don't let the government money change your mind.
Yes. Well, you
know. One more question over here.
I think that
one's
worth the
money.
My question is, as I mentioned to you, I know last year in the state of Georgia we spent $2.4 billion on illegals. And my question for you is, since we're not enforcing our legal immigration laws across the federal government at all, and here in Georgia in 2007 we passed the SAVE Act. And the SAVE Act, one important part of that SAVE Act was that no illegals could get a business license unless they signed an affidavit, which obviously we could prove they were not citizens, they did not get that business license. 2 years ago, I went to our commissioners here in Forsyth, and I brought that up. And I was really surprised to find out that out of our 159 counties across Georgia, less than 10% of our counties are enforcing that SAVE Act. And I was wondering, who could I go to at the Capitol? Would it make a difference? I'm up here in Forsyth. We are supposedly, I talked to the chamber up here. I don't think they liked it, but they said that they are enforcing that law. Who would I go to at the Capitol to try to make sure all 159 counties, because Georgia has more illegals. We're the sixth leading state as far as illegals go. We're in front of Arizona. And it surprised me. Who would I go to at the Capitol to try to get some action?
Well, you know, the governor has went along with every piece of immigration reform that we've had. I've chaired immigration reform in the Senate. SB 40, which was the E-Verify part of the bill that come out, which was SB 87. That was combined with SB 87. We have one of the most stringent immigration laws in the country. But to answer your question, I mean, you need to get a point where we go and sit down and talk to him about that. Now, you know what the problem that is. It's not being funded. It's not being funded. And as long as we have the current administration in the White House, it's going to be hard to get it funded. You know, that's the problem. Now, you know, we just got a favorable ruling from the judge on the part of the HB 87 that was thrown out. And he said that we were legal and we could do that. We can stop it. You know, stop and verify, you know, whether they're here legally or not. So we just got that through the favorably on the judge.
Well, Senator, can't you find out for him instead of sending him to the governor's office? Just pick up the phone and call. Find out for him.
You want me to? Hey, I will find out
for him.
Yeah, thank you for that suggestion. I appreciate it. Okay.
Okay. Let's all stand up and put our hands together and thank Senator Murphy.
My heart is
Yeah.